Glory to his name.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Oh, precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this mountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Away, fallen
John chapter number 5. Hold your finger there, if you would, and turn to Psalm 107. John chapter 5 and Psalm 107. I'm going to read a few verses out of each one of these chapters. Psalm 107, we're going to read in verse number 23. It says, they that go down to the sea in ships, that do business in great waters, these see the works of the Lord, and his wonders in the deep. For he commandeth and raiseth the stormy wind, which lifteth up the waves thereof. They mount up to the heaven, they go down again to the depths. Their soul is melted because of trouble. They reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man and are at their wit's end. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he bringeth them out of their distresses. Amen. He maketh the storm a calm, so that the waves thereof are still. Then are they glad because they be quiet. So he bringeth them unto their desired haven. And then lastly, verse 31, oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Now, back in John chapter number 5, I want to read a few verses in here as well. After this, verse number 1, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. One thing that always amazed me about Jesus, may I say right here, is he was always at the feast of the Jews, but he also found them in the homes of sinners. Mm. And he was always rubbing elbows with people of lesser, you understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. He was at the top, but he was not afraid to go down and rub elbows with those that were on the bottom. Sure. And I'm very grateful for that this afternoon. Verse number, verse number 3, and these lay a great multitude, or wait a minute, verse number 2, now there was in Jerusalem the sheep market, a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. And in these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? What a question. And verse 7 says, the impotent man answered and said, Sir, I have no man. Some of the saddest words in our Bible. Sir, I have no man. Yeah. It goes on to say, When the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. And Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed and walk. And then lastly, verse number 9, And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And the same day was the Sabbath. Okay, let's pray. Lord, how grateful we are to be in your house tonight. Thankful, Lord Jesus, that we have the privilege to gather with the brethren. Thankful, Lord Jesus, we have the privilege to gather around the Word of God. Lord, these are precious things that we have in America, at least for right now. And Lord, we pray that you'd meet with us. We desire your presence. Lord, I desire your presence here behind the podium. Lord, I desire your presence, Lord, as I deliver what you've laid on my heart, Lord, that I would say only that which you'd have me to say. And Lord, help me to be a blessing to Pastor Calabretta and Mrs. Calabretta and his church. And Lord, they sure have been a huge blessing to me over all these years. And Lord, I just pray that you'd meet with us, Lord, and we'll thank you and praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I have found, and this afternoon probably going to be just a little bit different than what I have delivered so far today in the Sunday school hour and in the morning. But I want to talk this afternoon, and I really feel like this is what the Lord wants, where he wants me in these passages, and this what I'm going to tell you here. I'm not real good with outlines. Sometimes I've got a real nice outline, but then sometimes it doesn't have an introduction, and you have to make one up as you go, or and then it doesn't have anything at the end, so you got to finish it somehow. And then sometimes it's just one big long point from start to finish. But it's always based around the Word of God, and I think that's probably what counts.
Amen.
And so I'm thankful that my pastor is not so hard-nosed that he insists on if there's an A, there's got to be a B, and if there's one, there's got to be a two, and all that other mess. I think a lot of that, I mean, you look at Jesus' messages, and he didn't build sermons that way. So anyway, I don't know exactly how this will come out to you today, but hopefully it'll be a blessing. And I want to put preach or deliver this to you this afternoon on God helps people that are desperate, in desperate need. And we've seen back here in Psalm 107 that that's exactly what was going on in the few verses that we read. And it talked about people who were in trouble in those few verses that we read about. And it talks about the they that go down to the sea in ships that do great business in great waters. These see the works of the Lord. And my pastor preached a sermon on that one time, and it was an outstanding sermon. And he talked about people who are willing to go to great depths for the work and for the cause of Christ. They are those that see the works of the Lord. And if you're not willing to do that, if you're not willing to go down to those depths and go to those places, doubtful that you'll see the works of the Lord. Or if you do see the works of the Lord, maybe it's not going to be as at the depth that you could see it. And so these... they go down, and then there's trouble, and then it says in verse 30, then were they glad because they be quiet. And that reminds me of the disciples when they were in Mark chapter number 4 in a sinking ship. And it amazes me how these fellas, Pastor Calabretta, had been walking with Jesus and seen so many miracles that he had performed and seen all of the great things that Christ was. And they get in this tragedy or this trouble on the sea, and they're ready to give up, you know. And look with me in Mark chapter number 4 quickly. Mark chapter number 4, and this is the account of this very thing. So here we have a sinking ship. Literally, this ship is sinking. And in Mark chapter number 4, we'll read a couple verses out of this and and then go from there. But in Mark chapter number 4, verse number 37, look what the Bible tells us, or look what it shows us. Let me see. I got to find my place. I know I got so much writing in here. I try to find the Bible verses. Mark chapter number 4, verse 37, it says, and there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. It was okay, so the ship is full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. Okay, so here's the men. They're getting ready to perish. And Jesus is asleep. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly, saying one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Amen. And that's our Jesus today. And that's still the same Christ that we serve, is the one who the winds and the seas obey. Yep. And listen, you never see a tropical storm or a hurricane coming or a hailstorm coming that our Savior is not in charge of. And you know what? Just like nature and weather, in our own lives, it's the same exact way. We never face a storm that Christ is not in control of. But boy, we sure do a bunch of pining, don't we? And I do this the very same thing. But the minute that Jesus speaks the word, there's peace. Peace. Absolute peace. So God helps those who are desperate. Now you got this man here in John chapter number 5. And you know what? This, everywhere Jesus went, everywhere he went on purpose. There was always something waiting for him and the disciples that where they needed his assistance or his healing or his help. And in every one of these passages that we'll go to today, we'll see that very thing. And in John chapter number 5, I don't really know, you fellows that have been in the ministry a lot longer than me, you may have preached on why they're waiting for the angel and the healing in the pool and all that other business. But here I see this guy who has no man that'll help him up. Now, I'm reminded this afternoon of the 7 billion people around the world, and many of those people have no man.
Yeah.
No man. And Brother Overton,
yes,
where you got that, where you're trying to help that church get going again, you know, I can almost guarantee that there are people in that community, whether it be 1 or 10 or 20 or 50, that would trust Christ if we could get to them, if we could find them. I think that's a great work, what you're doing, and I'm glad to give you a box of tracks to help you, but or to help that church. But here he is. He says, I have no man. But, you know, this guy is just looking for a physical healing. But Jesus says, wilt thou be made whole? Whole. You know, it's one thing to have a physical problem and have the Lord heal that. But this guy's got a physical problem and a spiritual problem.
Yes, sir.
And you know what? Physical problems are terrible. And it's a lot of times God will use physical problems to bring people to himself. A lot of times people will say, why is God doing this to me?
Yeah.
To bring you to himself.
Amen.
To bring you to himself. And I don't like being around people. And I hope you don't misunderstand what I'm about to say. I don't like being around people that ain't got no problems. Because I got a lot of problems. My life is full of problems. And if you're trying to do anything for the Lord, you got trouble as well. I mean, when you're trying to get people to Jesus, never, never think that the devil is just going to lay down and roll over and say, go get as many as you can. He ain't going to do it.
No,
the minute you, like today, putting out these gospel tracts, there is a target on your back.
Mm-hmm.
We've had a fellow, and you know the story, who was recently, he was saved at Calvary Hill Baptist Church, called to preach at Calvary Hill Baptist Church. He was a deacon at Calvary Hill Baptist Church. He was a Sunday school teacher at the Calvary Hill Baptist Church and a youth director and ran a major ministry out of our church. And I didn't say his name yet, did I,
no.
Brother Tony? Good, okay, I'm not going to. And then for 8 years ran this ministry, and the ministry was such that the devil was very angry. I mean, now you do anything for the Lord, whether it's just pass out a gospel tract or start a major ministry, you got a target on your back. But this fella had a great big target on his back. And the devil got him. The pressures of the ministry, he crumbled under those pressures, and today is out of church and finished with the ministry, is teaching elementary school, and so on and so forth. But that's exactly what we're up against, see? And when we are trying to help people, not just out of their physical ailments, but out of their spiritual ailments. And I like going to people that are I like to go to people. Let me just put it this way. Me and my visitation partner, a lot of times we will have left. He's not my visitation partner because my wife is. But when we were together, we would go into some fairly dangerous places together, because a lot of times when you get in those places, those people understand and know that they've got a need.
Yes, that's
now, if you go to a certain part of Spartanburg where the houses are $250,000, and the driveways are concreted and not paved or stoned, and you know, all the shrubs are manicured and all that other business, we've been run out of there and even had the law called on us. Those people have so many things in this world, they have no idea that they have a need.
Yeah.
But if I go down and talk to the prostitute with my partner now, I don't go talking prostitutes by myself. You got to be wise as a serpent, harmless as a dove. And it's not that I would ever consider buying a prostitute, but all some woman these days got to say is just one word, and you're going to jail.
Yeah.
So it's, you got to have a witness. So we'd go down there, and we would talk to these people. They were drug users, drug pushers, homeless people, people's lives just a complete wreck. And we had so much fruit and so much joy working down in those places with those people. I mentioned our bus church this morning, and the reason I did mention those is because the other church, I never told you this, but the other church in Union, they started a bus church, and they started going to our neighborhoods and started saying, what are you doing in our territory?
Wow.
So we just moved. We just went to another territory. Now, thank God for another church that's willing to get out and do something for the Lord and get kids to Christ. But in some of these areas we go to, it's just completely, it's all black people. All black people. And the very first time we went in here with our bus, number one, they're looking at this busload of white people wondering, what are you guys doing here? We parked the bus, and our young people are getting off the bus. And when we got in there, the music was bumping.
Yeah.
Okay? The people were, all of the people were in the streets and they were dancing and doing their thing. And they didn't know what we were doing in there, but they were wondering. But the minute, listen to this, the minute they understood who we are and where we were from, all that stopped. They turned the radios off, they turned the music off, they quit the dance, and they quit all the horsing around, and you found them like this. I used my track as a, you give them a gospel track, and you walk away, and you turn around and look at them, and they're doing this. Now, in our area, black folks are very superstitious. And when it comes to people of the cloth, so to speak, preachers or people who are peddling the gospel, they're very, very respectable. Very respectful. And but those people, most of those people are in desperate need. And I just hate to say this. I don't mean this in a bragging way. But until Calvary Hill Baptist Church started the bus church and started going in there, there was nobody in there trying to reach those people. Mm-hmm. If we're going to win America or the world for that matter, we've got to get down and actually touch people who are at the bottom. Amen. And these kids... we pick up these little black kids from, and we might have three Hispanics and two white kids, two white girl twins that come from Union, and that's it. The rest of them are black. And some of them are, they come from, if they're potty trained, they can get on the bus if their parents will let them. Mm-hmm. Potty trained, we don't fool with no diapers, no messes like that. All the way up to, we've had mothers on the bus. Some of those kids live in such squalor, such filth. And they just love going to bus church, and they eat up all the snacks as fast as they can get them. Sure. And I've been in so many of their homes, and they got blankets up for curtains, and they got blankets up for doors, and it's disgusting. But you go in there, and you sit down. You don't worry about what you just sat on, whether it's wet or not. You're there to give the gospel. Yes. And some of those kids, they call me daddy. Mm. These little black kids, when they see me, daddy, and they come and jump up into my arms and hug me. Some of them call me papa. And it's just so rewarding to be able to get down. They are in desperate need. Amen. And somebody's got to get to them. So these guys were on that sinking ship. Turn with me to Mark chapter number 5, another very familiar passage of Scripture. Mark chapter number 5, just a chapter next. And this is a very familiar story. And when I preach my testimony, I preach it out of Mark chapter number 5. And here's this guy right here who, when Jesus, again, here he is. He's going over there on purpose. On purpose. This is not just, he's not just happening to go over the Sea of Gadarenes. He's going over there on purpose because there's somebody over there that needs him, and this guy's on the bottom. Does anybody in here know anybody that lives in a cemetery or among the tombs? I don't. This guy was. And man, he had some desperate needs. Desperate needs. And you know what I like about Mark chapter number 5? Verse number 4, let's just start verse number 1, go through 5. And they came over onto the other side of the sea into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling, lived there among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because he had often been bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. Verse number 6, I love this, but when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him. So here's a guy that's got some serious issues. He's a cutter, commonly known as a cutter. I mean, I don't know if you know what the term cutter here means, but when Jay had, when he had those, some of those girls coming into that home, some of them were cutters, and he had to deal with all that. Yeah. And so here's this guy, and I believe it's a demonic spirit. I think they're demonic driven to do these kind of things. And so here's this fellow. But what I find interesting is there were actually people who made an effort. He made an effort to try and reach this guy. They made an effort to help him out of his problems, but they couldn't do it. And you know what I liken this to? And I liken it to my own testimony, Alcoholics Anonymous. That was a chain and a fetter that they put on me.
Yeah.
Okay? But it never did anything. Pastor Calabretta, I broke those chains and those fetters. My wife, okay, in the early days, before we were born again, she would threaten me with her presence in my son. It's us or the bottle. And I obviously wanted them, but I broke those chains and fetters. She tried to tie me down, but the power of the booze won out every time. The court system tried to put chains and fetters on me.
Yeah.
Broke those. Lost my license. When I got to South Carolina, I didn't even have a license. And so here it is. This is what they're trying. They've got all these man-made inventions and programs to try and change this poor guy, and he broke every single one of them. Broke every one.
Yeah.
But then Jesus showed up on the scene. Now, see, that's what fixed me. Okay?
Yeah.
That's what fixed me, and it fixed me for good. I'm not a recovering alcoholic like AA likes to say it.
Yeah.
I'm recovered.
Amen.
I'm not an alcoholic anymore. I'm not a boozer.
No.
Like I used to be, and I'm glad I can say that today. I'm glad I can say it wasn't the judicial system. It wasn't the law. It wasn't my wife. It wasn't AA. It wasn't any organization. It was all Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen. Exactly right.
Jesus. And you know what? For the same people, I know people who were saved out of the same background as me, and they will not go and talk to a drunk about Jesus. What in the world are they thinking? That's looking down your long spiritual nose at what you used to be, but you forgot where you came from. I haven't forgotten. Now, it's been 20 years, but I haven't forgotten where I come from, Brother John. I remember vividly what I was before Jesus, and I will gladly go to somebody laying in their own vomit. It don't bother me a bit. Because that individual has a need. So this maniac, man, he has a real need. Men have tried to win him and with their own ideals, but they could not do it. And then Jesus showed up on the scene, and it was a whole different situation. Verse number 17, and they began to pray him out to depart out of their coast. Because the presence of Christ in a changed life really scares people.
That's right.
It really scares people. I wish I could say I've won all my old drinking friends. But when I come around, they get very nervous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay? So the best I can do is just pray for them. I've witnessed to them. I've given them tracts. I've done all those things that I'm supposed to do. But it's up to the Lord to do the finished work.
Right.
And so they wanted him out of their coast. And when he was come into the ship, I just absolutely love this. And I know you've seen this already. He that had been possessed, had been, past tense, had been possessed, with the devil, prayed him that he might be with him. Now, what better thing would that be than to get born again and just go to be with Jesus? Forget this old world. Let's go be with him.
Yes, sir.
Well, that's what this guy wanted. And we want that today. The rapture of the church.
Sure.
Howbeit, Jesus suffered him not. And this is just a great commission verses I've ever seen in the Bible. You know, Mark 16:15, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, so on and so forth. You know how it goes. Well, here it is. This is the same thing. He said, you can't go with me, in other words. He says, go home to thy friends and tell them.
Yeah.
Go home and tell them.
Yeah.
What great things the Lord hath done for thee.
Yeah.
And the greatest story, I've got, if you read my testimony, which is in the drug-free track, part of my testimony, just a short section of my testimony, is in that track, along with a couple other fellows in our church who were saved out of the same background. A lot of people at Calvary Hill Baptist Church. Matter of fact, probably 80% of the people at Calvary Hill Baptist Church have been saved out of that kind of a background. And so, my testimony's in there, and a couple others are in there. And the first thing I tried to do was I tried to tell my people about Christ and how the Lord had compassion on them. And he departed and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for them, and all men did marvel. And what I was saying was, those guys, I've used their testimonies when I've been out preaching and sharing the ministry, but the greatest story I can ever tell is my story. And many times when I'm out passing out tracts or knocking on doors or doing the work of an evangelist, that's what I do. I just tell people what Jesus did for me. It's the greatest thing you can do. So that maniac, he had problems, and Jesus showed up on the scene, and he fixed everything, all right? And the dying daughter, Luke chapter number 8, Matthew, Mark, Luke chapter number 8. Here's another one. Luke chapter number 8, desperate. I can relate to this one. Luke chapter number 8, verse number 40. Luke 8:40. The Bible says, and it came to pass that when Jesus had returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. Mm-hmm. They were all waiting for him. It amazes me that the people that, the actual people that we're talking about here, they really needed Jesus. But you know what? There was a multitude of people that were following Christ that never really cared anything about having a relationship with Jesus. They just liked it because there was food there, for one. And they got to see these wondrous miracles, but they never got close to Jesus. And you know, isn't that the same today? There's really not a lot of people that have a desire to get really close to Jesus. Right. Most people go to church and think it's just a great idea. It's a good thing to do, to just go to church and be around God's people. Yeah, that's good. But get close to Jesus? Nah, I got no interest in that. I want to be close to Jesus.
Amen.
I want to be close to Jesus. Yeah, because I'm a likable guy, and you don't take much for me to like people. I don't hate people. Anything like that, but I've been stepped on, you've been stepped on, everybody's been stepped on, everybody's been hurt or injured in the ministry especially.
Sure.
And I have been injured by some very key people in my life, but Jesus, one glimpse of the Son of God changes everything.
Yes.
Changes everything. And so we got the story here of Jairus's daughter, all right, and you know how it goes. Verse number 41, and behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him how that he might come into his house, for he had only one daughter, one and only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay dying. But as he went, the people thronged him. Okay, so there's a lot of people there, and women, and a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all of her living upon physicians, could not be healed of any. So you've got Jairus' daughter, and you've got this woman with the issue of blood. You got a double banger here.
Yep.
Two people who are desperate. This girl is dying.
Yep.
She is dying. And this woman, she spent every dime she's had on doctors and still is none the better.
Yep.
All right? And then verse 44, we'll go down there, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood stanched. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" And everybody denied. Peter and they that were with him, you know, they said, "Master, the whole multitude throngs you. What do you mean? Everybody's touching you." And he says, "Somebody hath touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me. It's this woman." There was all kinds of people with Jesus there today, but this one woman was desperate.
Yeah. Amen.
Desperate. And we go to churches. I mean, I go all over the country, and I'm in churches with 10 people, churches with 250 or 300 people, and there's only a handful of those of people in those congregations that have a real need in their lives or realize it. And are willing to touch the hem of the garment. And so, and when the woman saw, verse 47, she was not hid. She came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him and all the people what cause she had touched him and how she was healed. And Jesus goes on to say, "Daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith hath made thee whole." And go in peace. Whole. She's whole. Just like the guy at the pool of Bethesda, "Wilt thou be made whole?" Listen, you're never whole until you're whole in Jesus.
That's
all right?
Right.
And so while all this is going on, one of Jairus's people come and say, "She's dead." All right? Verse number 49. "Trouble not the master, your daughter is dead." And but when Jesus heard it, he answered and said, "Fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole." Now, I don't have a daughter in this case, but I've got a son in this case. All right, and he's not saved. And so many times I've drawn comfort from this passage of Scripture where God has told me, "Fear not, believe only."
Yeah.
All right, my son is going on 29. He's not saved, but guess what? He will be saved.
Yeah.
I believe it with all my heart. My son will come to know Christ. All right,
yeah.
And so here we have another incident, a couple incidents of people who were desperate and had gone to their wits' end, and none the better. And so When you find yourself, when an individual, when a child of God finds himself completely at the end of their rope, they have nowhere else to go. They don't know what to do. Be comforted this afternoon that the Master has his eyes on you. So, and we've already talked about this. The Gospels are silent to the dramatic life changes of the faceless people. And that's all they are, is faceless people in the crowd. And many of them there for whatever reason besides to know Christ and to be close to him. And so we find through all of this, all of these people, from the disciples in the boat to the maniac Gadara to Jairus and his daughter to the woman with the issue of blood and even to the guy with at the pool of Bethesda, all of these were desperate people. So in short, the ship made it to shore.
Amen.
Now, the disciples didn't think they was going to make it. Lord, we perish. They were convinced that they were going to die. Now, have you ever been in a trial where you thought, there's no way I'm going to make it through this? There's no way I'll make it through this. You ever been there?
Yeah.
I've been there. But guess what? I made it through.
Amen.
I got to the other side. Just Jesus got me to the other side. The maniac, he found healing and peace in Christ. Don't you know that that maniac had completely given up? He had given up. But guess what? He found the healing that he needed. The dying daughter, that was a pretty hopeless situation, wasn't it? Now, what would we do? If one of the servants came and said, don't bother the master anymore. She is dead. She's dead. Jesus, his specialty is raising the dead.
Amen. That's right.
I mean, yeah. If you, and this, I'm not giving you anything you don't already know or haven't already considered, but everywhere Jesus went and there was death, it didn't remain death. Never, never, never did he go to where somebody was dead that they didn't come up out of the grave or come up off the pyre, whatever.
Yes, sir.
Life, because Jesus is life.
Amen.
Jesus is life. And there's a slew of people outside the doors of this auditorium who are destined for death, but there's life and we've got it.
Amen.
We've got it. So the ship made it to shore and the maniac found healing and peace. And the daughter was restored, not just to life. You know what? I guess God could have brought her from death to life, and she could have still been sick. But there was complete healing. She got up and cooked. Isn't that crazy? The woman's bleeding had stopped. Look. I'm going to say this woman must have been a wealthy woman. And she leaned on them finances and the ability to pay these so-called doctors for her healing. And she spent, Bible says she spent every single dime she had. Every dime. She spent it all. And was none the better. And you know, isn't that a picture of false religion in a reality? Because people completely give themselves over to their religion and the things they love. And when they come down to the end, they're none the better.
Right.
None the better.
Yeah.
All of it, a waste. Well, she got what she had finally. And you know what? She found out she did not need any money. Mm-hmm. Ain't you glad about that? I'm glad that I'm a blood-washed, born-again child of God today, and I'm glad that I'm not trusting my folks to go to the priest and pay him to pray me out of purgatory.
Yeah.
Man, oh man, what was that story about that? Somebody's family had died, and the priest said, if you'll come every week and give me so much money, you know, I'll pray him out. So they would, I don't know if it was a daughter or a brother or sister, whatever, would go weekly and give the priest the money. And so he would say, well, I got a foot prayed out. And then she'd go and say, I got a leg prayed out. And they'd go and give more money. And then he'd say, man, I got them prayed out from the waist down. And then I got one arm prayed out, and then they didn't show up no more to give the priest any more money. So the priest went and found out, why have you been back? And they said, well, we know Johnny, if you got him prayed out that far, he'll get out himself. But that's just about as ridiculous as the Catholicism religion anyway, isn't it? And they're counting on works. What does Ephesians 2, 8, 9 say? For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I would love, I never have, but I'd love to go and ask them, what do you do with that? What do you do with that passage of Scripture? Because it completely slaughters that whole religion. It slaughters any religion outside of trust in Christ and Christ alone. So she found out. She didn't need any money. She didn't need no doctors. All she needed was one little tiny touch of Jesus, the hem of his garment. Just one little touch. That's all it takes.
Yeah.
Isn't that? That's how simple salvation is.
Amen.
And so her bleeding will stop. Now, if you are in a serious need today, Christ is the answer.
Amen.
Christ is the answer. And I'm just assuming that everybody in this room is born again. I'm just assuming everybody in this room is born again. You assume that I'm born again. But all we can do is look down. All we can do is look at the physical and listen to the. We can look at the person and listen to what they're saying. But God, He looks right down on the heart,
right.
And He knows exactly what we are. See, and so not only is He all that we need for a physical healing, but He's all we definitely need for spiritual healing.
Yes, sir.
And so I implore you today, in any, whatever the case may be in your life, look to Jesus. Really, it's just that simple.
Amen.
Look to Jesus.
Amen.
Pastor Caliban.
Amen. Amen. I know I was desperate before I got saved. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Thank you for that message. I want to just take some time and just, you know, ask some questions and that, not much time because I know you need to get on the road. But how's your support level? Be honest with us.
It goes up and down.
Goes up and down.
Yeah.
Churches drop you and then some others take you on, that kind of thing.
Yeah, and then some support is slashed from one amount to another amount, you know, lower amount, and so on.
Okay. And of course, printing costs keep going up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, with papers always going up. And see, the thing is, when I print, there are some printers that they'll use anything they can get their hands on.
Yes.
We don't operate that way.
Mm-hmm.
We buy good, clean, well-cut paper from a major supplier.
Amen.
For so many reasons.
Mm-hmm. It runs through the press better, I know that much.
It runs through the press so well. And if your press is running good, you're not wasting
chemicals,
you're not wasting ink, you're not wasting paper, you're not
wasting time either.
Time.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And like I said this morning, our time is short.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that kind of paper, having said that, that paper is never cheap. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah.
So. But I believe it honors the Lord.
Amen.
Ink and cleaning chemicals and so on.
Yeah. There's a lot that goes into it.
Yeah.
A spool of wire for the stitcher, that's not any cheaper than it was, I imagine.
Right. And glue.
Glue for your glue bindings.
So we got glue. And
keep up the machinery and all that. So. That's incredible. Mm. Yeah. Okay. Any other things? Pray for him and his ministry, that some people come along to help. And I don't know when you and your wife have gotten a vacation.
Well, to be perfectly honest with you, we have not taken off really. I mean, there's a lot of time to travel around, but we've always got meetings and places to go and things to do. But
you haven't had a vacation since this ministry.
No. But I told my pastor, I asked my pastor, I said, the week of our anniversary,
for that 30th anniversary coming up, you'd like to be able to take off.
Yeah. I'm going to take her away for a few days.
Amen.
I'm going to try and take her someplace where nobody knows us.
Amen.
Nobody's expecting anything from us. Mm-hmm. I'm probably going to skip church.
Mm.
No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
No. But this will be the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And since we've been in the ministry, we've been 15 years.
Yeah. So. Amen. Good. Another question I have. You know, have you gotten some people to write to you, I got saved, and from out of country? They've written back to Calvary Hill.
There have been, I've got some stuff back there at home.
Mm-hmm.
Where folks have written to us.
Praise the Lord.
I wish I had more.
Yeah.
I tell you what we mainly get, Pastor Calvary, is our people who are working the streets,
mm-hmm.
who contact us, email us, and tell us,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
these people got saved, this one got saved, or that.
Yeah,
that's what we get more than anything.
More than that.
Yeah.
Good.
We got a lot of people working in a lot of jail ministries, and we get reports back from those as well.
Sure. Good. So. All right. Questions from any of you?
So
yes.
What languages do you have for tracks for Calvary in Spanish?
English, Spanish.
Tagalog.
Tagalog, yeah. French.
French.
German.
Mm.
We just finished one in Japanese. Telugu, mm-hmm. which goes for India.
For India.
Yeah.
Mm.
And I know I'm missing something.
Well, you're going to be doing the one in, you said, Farsi.
In Farsi. Yeah.
Yeah. No.
Gospel John in Farsi.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no. Praise the Lord.
Creole.
Open up for more languages, but what it takes is people willing.
Sure.
Willing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Willing to translate.
Translate, proofread it again and all. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Anything else? Questions?
So the equipment now? Anything going well?
Yeah. Yep, okay. we got a new plate maker.
You did tell us in the letter, yes.
We got a different plate maker in there, and we still got the old one just sitting there. I'm probably going to end up junking it, but that's going again. And everything, as of right now, is operating, but we are going to have to replace our glue binders getting really tired.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't really, it's a tabletop, it really wasn't designed for what we use it for and what we put it through.
Mm-hmm.
But the Lord has kept his hand on it.
Amen.
I've had to repair it on several occasions. But that's probably going to be the next thing that I'm really praying the Lord to replace is that glue binder.
Amen. Has it got a grinder on it?
It does.
Yeah.
It does.
So what it does is it takes all the pages and it has to kind of ruffle up the edge with a grinder, and then that goes through the glue, and then here's the cover that puts it all together and presses it. And it goes on that way.
Yeah.
So that's what a glue binding machine does.
Yeah. And like I said, ours is a tabletop. I'm asking the Lord to give us a floor model.
Floor model.
Something sits on the floor. A large machine. It's a large machine. It'll take up a good bit of space.
Mm-hmm.
But it will make. I'm not really satisfied with ours.
Looks wonderful.
But I really think if we had, let's say, and I know nobody knows what this is, but a Rossback 880. Because I've done a lot of research and looked at them, and to me, that's really what. Now I'll take whatever the Lord let me have.
Yeah.
I'm really that'll be a nice, and then a three blade knife maybe.
Hmm.
You know.
Okay, he's talking about a cutter that all at once it'll cut the three sides that needs to be cut.
Yeah.
So
trims it. And right now we're just using our single.
Single.
And just turning everything.
Turning everything.
My wife turns everything, you know.
Right.
And she can cut, you know, a dozen books at one time.
Right.
But she just got to turn everything to get all three opening sides of the book.
Right.
Where the three-blade trimmer, you put a whole stack of books in there, and three knives come down at once. And they kind of come down at angles and meet together and slice off all the opening edges of that book.
Mm-hmm.
Real nice.
Yeah.
So what we have is working, and the Lord is using it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a goal.
A goal.
Moving forward.
So we need to pray for him to get a four-color press, because he's using a two to do four-color now. So a four-color press, a new glue binder, a new trimmer.
Yeah.
And you don't do too much stitching then. You don't do too many staples, what we would think of as staples.
We have a perfect binder, a staple binder.
Yeah.
But we rarely use it because people don't even want them. They want this glue bomb.
Glue bomb, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, okay. Other questions?
Are your daughters working in the ministry as well? And
well, my daughters do help me, but they're not full-time in the ministry. Frankly, both of them work jobs. I don't mind them working out in the working world. Both of them are very avid about getting people to church, co-workers and such.
Mm-hmm.
So they're still, they're busy.
Yeah, yeah.
So maybe they're not actually in full-time ministry, but they're still in ministry.
Yeah.
Trying to get people in church, trying to get people to go
there.
Yeah, and that's what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Very important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he's also got a shrink wrap machine. All those packs of tracks that are in that little pocket has to be cut the right size, then goes through a heat tunnel, it shrinks it all down. The heat tunnel's got to be the right temperature, and the right time is probably the time the belt goes through. So, yeah.
It goes too fast, it
doesn't shrink it, right? It goes too slow, it'll shrink them up so that they're a crinkled up mess. Yeah. Or burn them. I've seen that too.
Yeah, and you have to redo it.
Yeah.
When we have, sometimes young people who come in and help us, and the two machines that amaze them the most is the folder three actually, the cutter.
Yeah.
Because the cutter is hydraulic, and if you stick your arm in there, it'll just, with no problem,
no.
It won't even grub.
No.
And just take your arm right off.
Yeah.
So you can put a whole ream of paper in there, plus another ream, and it'll just cut through every bit of it.
Oh, yeah.
No,
no
problem. People are always amazed at that. And then folder, which folds, literally
thousands
of pieces of literature
a minute.
Thousands.
Yeah.
And so they love to watch them. They love to watch them all coming down,
Yeah.
And then the shrink wrap. They like to get on the shrink wrap.
Shrink wrap, yeah.
And they'll say, can I shrink wrap this Frito? Can I shrink wrap this pencil?
Yeah.
I let them.
Yeah.
Do you have a beam on that cutter so they can't?
The cutter won't activate unless you get your hands on the two buttons.
Yeah,
and you can't, if you let go, it'll stop coming down, back up again.
I wonder, because I knew they were that way.
Yeah.
Now, we did have one that had no safety mechanisms on it whatsoever.
Yeah.
It had a giant lever, and you pull that giant lever back, it whacked.
Yeah.
We got rid of that one.
Yeah.
We didn't have it very long.
Yeah.
Too many young little kids around.
Yeah, when I first started, that's the kind we had. That just
a big manual clamp.
Yeah, yeah, big clamp, and you could get your hand in there. Which,
it was very dangerous.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Is there a way to see all that you have available, track-wise?
On the website.
The website has.
Yeah, the website has. There's a few of them that are not on the website yet, just simply because I got to get with our fellow, one of our deacons. He's our trader as well. Also does our website.
And they can be ordered through the website?
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if we let him know with enough lead time, he can print our church information on there if there's enough space.
Yeah, there's enough space on all of our tracks except for maybe two.
Yeah.
Don't have enough space. And that question mark track has enough room for address, phone number, schedule, services, and all of
those. Looks like you can stamp. Enough room on some of these.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Brother Walsh, we love you. Thank you for your good messages, and we love your ministry, and we think it's doing some great things around the world, and heaven's going to be a great place of rejoicing.
Yes.
Yeah, it really is. And there'll be a lot of people say, I got paper preacher.
Yeah.
Came to know Christ as Savior. All right. Any other questions? Well, all right. Let's stand again, and we'll dismiss in prayer. And Brother John, close us, if you would.
Lord Jesus, we want to give you thanks, Lord, for the word. And we thank you, Lord, that your word is written for us today. And we thank you that that written word is going out to all the world today. It's going all over, Lord. And yes. We thank you that there's power in the gospel. Mm-hmm. We thank you, Lord, that you rose again from the dead after 3 days. And we just praise you, Lord, that you're alive today at the right hand of the Father, and that thy word is as powerful as when you first spoke it as it is today. And may that word, Lord, go forth and do what it does. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. And just keep piercing, Lord, souls with thy word, and help us, Lord, to take that word forth and to share it with others. And may you prepare the hearts, Lord, that it be received. You know, with that want that we saw this afternoon, there were people, Lord, seeking. And guide us and lead us to those, Lord, that are seeking after you, that are just down in the depths and need thy word, Lord. And so please continue to bless the ministry of Brother Walsh, and watch over his family, Lord, and move in the power of thy Holy Spirit upon Brother Walsh's son. That he may soon, Lord, come to salvation in Jesus Christ. Lord, believe on you, Lord. And
yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, that you're the only way. We thank you that there's no other way to heaven but through you. And may many souls, Lord, be saved in this town. Just again, lead us, Lord, where you want us to go. And may thy will be done in it all. And we praise you and thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. And bless Brother Walsh's ministry this evening, Brother Overton's ministry. Amen. Yep, praise God. Hallelujah. Amen.